Children Come First, sponsored by CK Auto Parts. Children Come First, hosted by Dr. Daria Brzezinski. And now, at 10 o'clock, here is Dr. Daria Brzezinski.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This morning we have a wonderful guest, Chris Mercogliano. He's been a teacher at the Albany Free School since 1973 and a co-director since 1987. He received his teacher training and apprenticeship studies at Empire State College, the State University of New York School Without Walls program. Chris has been writing essays and book reviews for the Journal of Alternative Education for the past 12 years. His work has also appeared in Friends Review, the Albany Times Union, the Journal of Family Life, Passive Learning, and Deschooling Our Lives. His first book, Making Up as We Go Along, The Story of the Albany Free School, was published in 1998. Currently, he's working on another book, Rid of Him, or Why So Many Children Are Labeled and Drugged in Schools. Before we begin speaking with Chris, we'd like to tell you a little bit about our sponsor.
Children Come First with Dr. Daria Brzezinski is produced by Earth Heart Foundation in Charlottesville, Virginia. Children Come First is underwritten by CK Auto Parts with stores in Moosic, Scranton, Pittston, and Kingston. You can visit their website at www.ceekayauto.com.
Good morning, Chris. How are you?
Good morning. I'm fine. It's a beautiful day up here in Albany.
And we took you away from your school this morning. I'm sorry we did that, but could you tell us a little bit about the Albany Free School and how it started? I know it has, you wrote about it in your book. Tell us a little bit about how the Albany Free School started and where the concept came from and what kind of school it is.
Okay. It's a large question. We'll have to break it down into parts, I think. The school was started in 1969 by a woman in Albany named Mary Loya. Her husband was a philosophy professor at the State University, which is why they were living in Albany. They had five kids. The youngest son at that time, the youngest child, was a boy, was a fourth grade boy, was miserable in school. He was in one of the Albany public schools, and he was doing fine academically. He was a very bright boy, but he was miserable to the point where he began actually refusing to go to school. The problem was his teacher. It was an older teacher who was not enjoying herself, not enjoying her work, didn't seem to like kids very much. She actually apparently didn't end up finishing out the school year even. She had mental health problems, I guess. And then the Loyas had lived in other places like Texas and England, as Professor Loya traveled around to be a professor. And I think that all of Mark's earlier schools had been really nice, student-friendly, child-friendly schools. So it was a big shock to be here in Albany in a small city where the school was not a nice place to be. So Mark's mother, Mary, finally she tried working with the school and tried talking with the teacher, tried talking with the principal, tried joining the PTA, tried doing a number of things to make the situation for her son better. And when nothing was working, nothing was changing, she finally agreed to let her son stay home. And to make a long story short, the homeschooling didn't exist as a word at the time. I think you might say Mark was one of the first unofficial homeschoolers anyway in New York, but Mary actually made it official. She kind of fought it out with the state education bureaucracy and got official permission to teach her son at home. Don't think that had happened before in New York. And then...
What year was this again?
This was in 1969. And then, very quickly, the word got around to Mark's friends that he was getting to stay home with his mother and learn at home. So that they very quickly grew into a little school, which at first was based in the Loya's home, but within 2 years it had grown so quickly that they were in rented buildings and church basements, this sort of a thing. And then by 1972, the school was in its present location, which is an old parochial school building in the oldest remaining neighborhood of the city. So Albany's a very old city, and so the oldest residential district is where we are, and just sitting quietly on a street lined with row houses. And now the school has about 55 kids and 8 full-time teachers.
That's today?
That's today.
55 children and 8 school and 8 teachers.
Right.
What else? I know there's some unusual things, aspects about this school that you'd like to tell us about. Do I remember correctly, or didn't the community build up around the school?
Exactly. That's probably one of the more. There's a number of unusual things about our school, or fairly unique things, but one of them certainly is the fact that a small. Well, to tell it as a story, over the next 10 years of the school's history, once it was permanently located here in the South End, the teachers, young teachers like myself, and also some of the families of the children, settled on the very same block. The neighborhood at that time was probably at its lowest point. There were many, as was the case with many northeastern cities, there were many burned out buildings and bombed out buildings and abandoned buildings, slumlorded buildings, packs of wild dogs roaming around. I mean, it was a real ghetto. But the good news was that there was tons of inexpensive housing available on the block. I mean, buildings could be bought for as little as $500 from the county because they'd been repossessed because no one had paid the taxes. So the school, one of Mary's brilliant visions was for the school to buy a number of these properties up and then fix them up for various uses. In fact, today, 2/3 of the school's income comes from the property that we own, and only 1/3 from tuition. But then a lot of us young teachers and young free school families, we also bought our own homes and fixed them up together and with each other and on our own, with very little money, really, but a lot of Amish barn raisings occurred during that decade. And that and some other activities pulled us together quite closely. We had a lot of shared interests between the school and raising children. And slowly, kind of invisibly, a community, a true community coalesced. An intentional community of sorts where even today we have, we meet together regularly. We have a number of community enterprises.
How many families are there in the community?
I'd say about 15.
And you all live in the same neighborhood.
That's right.
How do you survive with so few students in your school? I mean, where do you get your funding from?
Well, we do a lot of things without money. I mean, that's the secret to our success. I'm not sure how much it can be copied, bottled and sold as a methodology, but it works for us. We don't have a lot of money. The overall budget for the school, I think, is about $70,000 a year or something, which means the per capita student cost is probably about 20% of the New York State-wide average. Because you see, about 50% of the school's students are from lower-income families, and we have a sliding scale tuition so that we're not exclusive. So the tuition, in the end, only, as I said, it only provides about 1/3 of the budget, and then the other 2/3 comes from income that the property that we own generates. We don't really depend on outside grants because that's tended to be fatal for most schools. Mary was pretty clear that the way to ensure longevity was for the school not to depend on grants and foundations because, what do you do when that money, if that money dries up and when it dries up? That was certainly the case with a great many of the free schools that were started up in the late 60s and early 70s with foundation money, because alternative education was quite cachet at the time. There was a lot of dissatisfaction at the time with public schools. But you had a lot of schools that went for 2 or 3 years, thanks to the Ford Foundation or the MacArthur Foundation, whatever. But they were just startup grants, and those schools were never able to come up with ways to become self-sufficient. So we do it by, doing without. We don't have a lot of fancy equipment. The building, isn't not a plush building. It's a 140-year-old, very serviceable building, but there's no fancy furniture, and we don't have thousands and thousands of dollars in Montessori equipment or whatever. We kind of make do with a lot of scrounged materials and hand-me-down equipment of one kind or another, and you know, the education that we practice is really quite, you know, it's quite basic. We're very old-fashioned.
What does that mean? What does old-fashioned mean to you?
Well, old-fashioned means that when I, you know, when I teach history, for example, you know, I rarely use textbooks. Instead, I mean, I prefer to teach history as a story, for one thing, especially the younger children. And then if we need further source material, you know, we'll go to the library. You know, we'll get some biographies out, or we'll hit the internet and find some information about someone or some event that way.
Now, with 50 children in the classroom, we need to get an idea of how you do this.
You've got 55 in the school.
Okay.
And then I'll describe the school building itself so you have a sense of how it goes. It's a two-story building. Half of the kids are in our preschool. Or not quite half. There's about 20 preschoolers. And they occupy the second floor of the building, which is primarily a big, wide open space. There's a small subdivision for a kindergarten, and then there's some, you know, play corner type of things for the little guys. Now the seventh and eighth grade, we actually had to build a loft when we got to be, you know, 40 or 45 kids. We were running out of space, so we built a loft in the preschool because it has very high ceilings. It was formerly a church. Originally it was a church. So we built a loft and a library, and that is occupied by the 10 seventh and eighth graders this year. And then the first floor of the building is divided up into smaller classroom space and a meeting room space, and you've got about 20, 25 elementary, you know, grades 1 through 6 kids on the first floor. So we have a fair amount of space. We'd love to have more. 55 students, believe it or not, fills the building. I mean,
it gets
to be very full of energy, you know, almost to the point of, I mean, you just don't want to, you don't want any more.
Now, it sounds like it's all open space. Is that it? There's no walls between any of the buildings?
It's not the case down on the first floor where the elementary age kids are. There are about 6 different rooms. And each you know, they have their own classroom space. And you know, it's fairly traditionally set up,
now,
I guess,
Do you teach the same subjects as other schools? Do you teach history, English, mathematics, social studies, language arts, the 5 core curriculum like everyone else does?
Yeah, I mean yes and no. We cover the same ground. We often tend to do it differently. Learning in our school, I mean, there's 2 major differences. First of all, learning in our school is by choice.
What does that mean?
It isn't compulsory. Kids have the right to refuse to go to a class if they so choose. They have the right to choose when and what to learn. We don't force kids to learn, and we don't manipulate them into learning with external incentives or punishments, you know, like grades and withholding privileges or, you know, this sort of thing. Our school, kids learn because they want to.
So you offer classes then? Is this correct? You offer like a math or a
mm-hmm.
reading class,
and if
children come, they come. If they don't, they don't?
That's right.
And
unless there's a prior agreement. I mean, there are cases where, you know, the kids, often a scenario will be, the kids say, we want to learn Spanish. Okay, so we'll find a Spanish teacher. If we don't have someone in the building who can, you know, can already do it. So we find a Spanish teacher. The Spanish teacher may say, okay, I'll teach you Spanish, but, you know, I want an agreement with you guys that, okay, we'll have 16 classes or whatever, and we'll have classes 3 mornings a week from this time to this time, and I want you to come every time. You know, that's my deal is you come every time, you come on time, there's going to be homework, whatever. I mean, the teacher will lay out his or her requirements. You know, and it's kind of a negotiation. And if the kids agree to that, then that's the deal. So it might be a different deal than the ordinary, you know, it might be different than the way other teachers might be proceeding. I teach math. I'm the math teacher in the school, and I don't do it that way. When kids want to do math, they do math. I'll call out. Sometimes they'll come and get me and say, let's have a math class. Or sometimes, you know, for a period of time, I'll say, okay, we're going to have algebra class. In fact, I have to go to an algebra class at 11. But I'll say, okay, for the next 6 weeks, I'm going to teach algebra from whatever, 11 to 12 on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. But I'm not going to care who, I'm not going to care, but I'm not going to insist that they come. You know, if they don't come on a given day, that's fine with me. I just, you know, I just sort of dance with that. And the kids who are really into learning, they come, they learn their algebra, they learn it at an incredibly rapid rate. You know, they'll learn in 6 weeks what the public school would cover in the entire school year.
Chris, let me take a moment here. You're listening to Children Come First with Dr. Daria Brzezinski, and we are talking with Chris Mercogliano. He's a teacher at the Albany Free School in Albany, New York. And free is definitely the word I like to use for it. If you'd like any information about Chris or any of the other topics that we speak about on this program, Children Come First, you may phone us at 877-PRO-KIDS. That's area code 877-PRO, P-R-O-K-I-D-S. If you'd like any information about our broadcast, we are here every Tuesday from 10 to 11 a.m. Chris,
the other big difference is that learning in our school tends to be, you know, project-based, or even beyond that, I like to just say reality-based.
What's the difference?
So it means that when kids, you know, if we want to address creative writing, rather than just put our kids through, you know, the paces of creative writing exercises, they'll make a book, or they'll come up with an idea for a magazine, or a newspaper, or something real, and they'll, you know, it'll just be their project for 2 weeks, and that might be the only thing they do for 2 weeks. You know, they don't do any math, they don't do any geography or whatever, they just, you know, knuckle down and go nuts creating a magazine, and I'm talking, the whole production will be theirs. They have to write the material. I mean, the teachers will help with editing and proofreading and spelling and so on, but they'll write the material. Usually it'll be a money-making thing, because kids love to make money. I mean, that's a very real, I mean, we all like to make money, and money is real. So the kids will go out and sell advertising to local businesses, and they'll put together a really nice, you know, nice-looking finished product that the fourth and fifth and sixth graders, I think, just finished this process because they want to go whale watching in Cape Cod. And that's going to be expensive. They're going to spend a couple of nights in a motel, and plus the whale watching fees. And I think they had to raise something like $2,400 to do this 3-day trip. So they just finished their magazine, and they managed to talk a local copy place into donating color copies for the cover. So that their magazine, it's a very fine looking piece of work. It's got a full 4-color cover, and you know, it's got about 25 pages of text and ads inside, and all the kids' stories and poetry and word games that they put together. And so that's what I mean by reality-based. There's their English. You know, there's their English curriculum for
whatever length of time
they worked on it.
Well, there's a lot of other things that are involved with it as well. The setup of the page, I mean, there's all sorts of things.
There's the computer skills,
entrepreneurial.
Because the kids do the computer layout.
Yeah.
That's right, the graphics, there's a lot of their artwork in there. So yeah, it isn't even just English, you're right, it's a very
broad-based,
holistic kind of a thing.
Now, it sounds to me like you and the teachers in your school have a sense of learning that reflects a philosophy that all children will learn no matter what. You're not using curriculum textbooks, you're not using the traditional kinds of things that most schools use, and it sounds like learning happened. A question I'm sure our audience might want to ask you is, where do your children, do you only go up to 8th grade?
Right, that's it.
Where do your children go, and how do they function when they go into a traditional high school? What happens to them when they have to be in a traditional high school?
Probably the most frequently asked question. There it is. Well, our kids come from a lot of different places. That's another unusual thing about us. We have inner city kids, we have uptown kids, we have suburban kids, and we have kids that come from the country, from quite rural situations. So we have an amazingly diverse student body, much more so than most schools. So where the kids go once they leave us, you know, is somewhat tied to where they're coming from and what their family situation is and what their income is and so on. But I would say probably 3/4 of the kids end up in one public high school or another in their, you know, nearest their home. and they do fine. They,
It sounds to me like they're independent learners.
It's a problem for them that, you know, the loss of freedom doesn't get in their way.
Really?
Is what I would say. They don't like it. I mean, they know the difference. They know that they don't... our kids tend not to, especially if they spend any time in our school, if they grew up in our school, they don't need that, all the external motivation stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you've got free school kids just, they want to learn. I mean, or they don't, but the incentive doesn't make a whole lot of difference. I mean, if they just flat out don't like chemistry, you know, they're probably still not going to do really well in chemistry. But if they love history, you know, they would sit there and study history until they turn the lights out. And they wouldn't care about the it wouldn't have to do with getting ready for the next test. It would have to do because they were really interested in the past.
Now, how well...
But they do well, and they tend to be very mature. And they're really, in a sense, already ready for college because they've already learned to organize their own time. They've already learned to make their own choices about, you know, what to do and when. They've already taken over the responsibility for their own actions because we... There's a lot of... There's a whole discipline system in our school that would be another story, but the kids, in many ways, they discipline themselves. They govern themselves. They create, you know, a large number of the school's day-to-day rules. Now, we have a whole self-governing structure that the kids, you know, just swim in, like fish swim in water. And so they have this inborn sense after a while of you know, it's their lives. They're you know, nobody else is going to live it for them. They're living their own lives, and so they tend to make good choices, and they tend to reach their goals, and not get distracted many children, not all children, but a great many children who've been educated conventionally and have just never had the practice of making choices.
So
our
what
kids are making choices every day by the dozens.
So what I'm hearing from you then is, are these children who have been educated in your school for at least an 8-year period then can go on to do other traditional settings in education without any problem and are able to adjust, even though they have been very independent and been the captain of their ships, so to speak, from their entire life, for the first 8 years of school in their life. And so they are able to go into a public school setting and or a college setting and be able to... How many children graduate from college from your school? I mean, is it a large majority? Or?
No, we've never kept track. I don't think it's the majority because of the demographics of our school. We've never kept track. We don't have time. We don't have a secretary. So I would say just a wild off the top of my head guess would be 50%.
Okay.
But I know plenty of kids who don't go on to college, and they're leading really good lives. You know, they didn't go to college because of a lack of ability, or, you know, they just really didn't. The ones that I know that have kept in touch, they just didn't choose to go to college. You know, they had other things they wanted to do. They went into a trade, they went into a business, they went into, you know, parent to motherhood if it's a young woman. But the things that they ended up doing, they did by choice. They did because it was in them to do, and they're enjoying what they're doing. You know, there's a young guy that graduated from the school many years ago. At this point, he's in his early 30s. He's a father of several children, and he's been running the nearest local coffee shop downtown, where all the law offices and government offices are. It's a busy place. He's been the manager there for about 10 years, and just, you know, enjoying himself. He makes more money than I do. He's enjoying himself. He's a great manager. I mean, he runs that store so beautifully. And in fact, so beautifully that one of the state offices for whom he does a lot of the copy work has just hired him. You know, they lured him away. The poor guy who owns the shop, you know, owns the store, is beside himself because he's just lost his best employee. But the state government office realized what they had, you know, who this guy was, and so he's now on the state payroll, and it's a little better for him. He'll have more benefits and retirement stuff, and it's a nice promotion for John. So that's just a little example of a guy who never went to college, but, you know, has no regrets. He is absolutely living a fine life, and he's getting everything he wants out of life.
So you feel then that your educational system that you have developed at the Albany Free School then gives children the opportunity to explore and to find the kinds of things that make them happy in their own lives for the rest of their lives. That first 8 years of education, you take them from K to eighth grade, is that correct?
No, age two through eighth grade.
Oh, two through eight.
Okay, we have a preschool
downstairs. So you, and how many children do you have in the preschool?
I said that the preschool, the age two through five, is about 20 kids right now.
Oh, that's a large group.
Yeah.
And so you...
The younger, the better.
What, are there any personal philosophies that you follow in your school? Is there any philosophical premise?
Yeah, there's quite a few, really. There isn't just one. When Mary started the school, she didn't follow, you know, any one particular model. She probably borrowed from a dozen and then created some of her own tricks, you know, as well. But I would say a big influence was the school in England called Summerhill, which was started all the way back in the 1920s.
Yes.
And was a school, was actually a residential school based on freedom, where the children governed the school and governed themselves. In fact, Mary corresponded regularly with the old guy, A.S. Neal, who had started Summerhill. Let's see, what else? Well,
I don't mean to, we're going to be taking a break here soon, so I don't want you to get in-depth too much in terms of a philosophical premise or a philosophical base.
That was a great, and I'd say the other major one was probably Mary's own New England upbringing, which was large, you know, based on a lot of independence and kids being treated as capable, even at a very young age, not nursed along.
Well, I'd like to tell our audience we're going to be taking a break soon and going to commercial. This is Children Come First with Dr. Daria Brzezinski on WAAT 750 AM on your dial. We are speaking here today with Chris Mercogliano. He's been a teacher at the Albany Free School since 1973. He's been writing essays and books for the Journal of Alternative Education, for the Albany Times Union, the Friends Review, the Journal of Family Life, Passive Learning, and Deschooling Our Lives. He also wrote a book called Making It Up as We Go Along, The Story of the Albany Free School. And we'll be right back in a few moments, so please stay with us. This is Children Come First by Dr. Daria Brzezinski.
WAAT Radio 750 is your official Stand for Children station. Sunday, June 13th is Stand for Children Rally Day. The place, the mall at Steamtown in downtown Scranton, beginning at 12 noon. This year's theme, Ready to Learn, Ready to Succeed. Area churches and child advocacy groups will rally, entertain, and inform in center court at the mall at Steamtown Sunday, June 13th, starting at noon, with a children's fair throughout the mall from 1 until 5. Schools, churches, child care centers are welcome to join in. The Way 750 will broadcast the opening ceremonies from noon to 12:30 on Sunday, June 13th. Take a stand for children and families and come on out to the Stand for Children Day 1999, Sunday, June 13th at the mall at Steamtown. For more info, contact Carlene Gula at 342-2874 and keep listening to us for updates.
Way 750, proudly salutes the children of Northeast PA.
These are the sounds of today's kids.
Problem that's hard to solve.
Give me tougher work. Give me tougher books.
When I solve a tough problem, I'm on top of the world.
Surprised? Don't be.
74% of kids say school should only pass them to the next grade when they've learned what's expected of them.
I'm not afraid to fail.
If I make a mistake, I'll do better next time.
75% of kids say they'd study harder if their schools gave them tougher tests. The fact is, almost all kids want to be challenged in school. So listen to the voices of kids today.
Challenge me.
Challenge me. Challenge me.
Do your part. Support higher academic achievement in Pennsylvania and challenge our schools to challenge our kids. For a free booklet, call 1-800-38-BE-SMART. A message from the Ad Council and the Education Excellence Partnership.
WAAT Radio 750 is home to the Irish Hour, hosted by Scranton's own Kieran Patrick Lochney, every Saturday afternoon from 12 noon until 1. Kieran has great Irish songs and stories, live events from Ireland, and special guests in our studios. This week, Kieran hosts Scranton Times columnist Joe Flannery for a lively Irish Hour, Saturday at noon, right here on WAAT AM 750.
This is Dr. Daria Brzezinski. We're back at Children Come First. We're meeting here with Chris Mercogliano from the Albany Free School. If you'd like any information about Chris's school or anything we speak about on this radio broadcast, you may call us at 877-PRO-KIDS, toll free. That's in Virginia. We also have a Pennsylvania station. Phone 570-639-2931. Chris, we were talking a little bit earlier about you produce a journal called the Journal of Family Life. Could you tell us a little bit about that magazine and perhaps how we can get a subscription for it?
Yeah, sure. Well, the journal is an outgrowth of our school, like a number of, I would say, school and community, as you know, the community that exists around the school. There have been a number of spin-offs over the years. When you stick around long enough, you keep, you know, coming up with new things that you think need to be done. So about 5 years ago, Mary Loya, who founded the school, who by this time, you see, is retired from daily teaching because she's into her 70s and just didn't want to have to come to work every day. You know, she began to stay home and develop her own little desktop publishing empire and still taught occasional classes to the kids in subjects they were interested in. But anyway, Mary said, we got to start this journal. We've got all this experience working with families over the years. We've learned so much about, you know, family dynamics and about successful child rearing, about how children learn, about relationships, about, you know, couples and how to deal with, you know, how to help couples who aren't getting along and so on and so on and so on. She said, we've got to, you know, reach a wider audience with the knowledge that we've and experience that we've accumulated. And so there it was, you know, that Mary just starts things. And she gets an idea, whether it's a school or a magazine, you know, it's just the next step is, well, you just start doing it. You don't need money, you don't need whatever. A group of us, mostly teachers in the school, but also some other community people, we started, more community people. We started meeting 3 mornings a week, 7:30 a.m., having editorial meetings and pulling together material and learning the business of running a magazine. Now, Mary had already been publishing Scholae, the Journal of Alternative Education, so she had already had, you know, a fair amount of publishing experience and a lot of editing experience, and she kind of led the way. But anyway, so we started putting the magazine together. We do a bit of an unusual thing, I think, in that we don't just cover topics immediately related to families and children. You know, we stray sometimes fairly far afield into other related topics, you know, like death and dying, we did an issue on, or we've done an issue on money, this sort of a thing. So we cover a lot of ground, and, you know, we've done very well. Some of our interviews and articles have been reprinted actually around the world in some fairly major publications, and We were nominated by the Utney Reader for an Alternative Press Award a few years ago, and so we like to think of ourselves as small but powerful. We just publish, we print 4,000 copies.
That's all, my goodness, I've seen it.
Four times a year.
I've seen it in different places. I'm amazed you only have 4,000 copies.
Right. Yeah, it's kind of a strange thing, because we're in probably in 200 Borders and Barnes and Nobles, and
about
a third of those copies are nationally distributed through, you know, big distribution chains. So we're in all the big bookstore chains and food co-ops, and, you know, we're around, but our subscribership is still, you know, we haven't had any money or time to really promote ourselves properly, so it's largely, you know, it's kind of word of mouth that, unless people see us in the bookstore, it's word of mouth that gets us around, and, you know, we'll just, I suspect we'll, you know, we will just grow slowly,
Chris, if we have listeners here, and our listeners need to take out their pencil and paper and perhaps write down some information about where they can subscribe to the Journal of Family Living, can you give us a phone number, please, or an email, or an address?
Yep, I'll give you the whole shebang. A subscription for a year is $22. So you can just send a check, if you want, to 22 Elm Street, Albany, New York, 12202, or you can phone us at 518-471-9532, or the email is jflmag@aol.com.
That sounds pretty easy. Can you repeat the phone number again?
I sure can. It's 518-471-9532.
All right, we'll give it again at the end of the program. I read in your book, Making It Up As You Go Along, the story of the Albany Free School, that you happen to, I don't want to say it in a negative way, but the public schools and the schools around you saw you as the answer to their prayers for the at-risk students in their schools. Is that true? Do they send their most difficult students to you to assist them, and what happens in the process?
Right. Sometimes, I would say. There are certain schools, certain school principals that know us and tend to regularly send us kids that aren't fitting in with them. And then we get, you know, it's probably a little more the case that parents themselves will hear about us one way or another, and will look to us as a school of last resort, or as a port in the storm, or whatever, if their child's not fitting in public school and having a hard time. So, I mean, what we do with those kids is pretty simple. We say to the parents, you know, your child is going to be a very different situation now. They're going to be in charge. They're going to have the right to say no. You know, they're probably going to say no, you know, if they haven't done well, if they've got a history of school failure. They're probably going to say no to, you know, learning in conventional terms for a while. They're probably going to take a vacation. And we say to the parents, that's really the best thing. I mean, they just need time to, you know, to debrief themselves, to decompress. Because for a child who's only known school failure or school trouble, you know, if they've been a, quote, troublemaker in school, for any length of time, it's kind of an embattled experience. And it leaves those kids, you know, generally angry, definitely turned off. You know, they tend to be suspicious of adults, often suspicious of each other, you know, just not very trusting of their environment, and so on. So they just need time.
How long does that decompression usually take?
It can last for an entire year. I mean, we will warn parents that it could be a whole year before you see your child pick up a book or, you know, express interest in math again or whatever.
I've spoken with homeschooling parents, and they've told me in the past that it usually takes the number of years that they've been in traditional school. That's how many years it takes for them to decompress.
Right. Well, we speed it up a little bit. I mean, I think that an advantage that we have by being a small school is that, you know, there are a lot of kids in the school, you know, who are very active learners and excited. The kids that we have that didn't spend a lot of time in public school or didn't have negative experiences, you know, they're just having a grand old time. They're working on projects and they're into stuff, and they tend to pull the turned off kids in. I think it speeds it up. You know, the turned off kids see these other kids, you know, willingly going to algebra class 3 days a week, you know, and having fun at it, you know, and we're laughing and kidding around, and, you know, it's just the way I teach math. It's fun. It's a game. And before you know it, some of these kids, you know, I'm having that's the case right now in the 7th and 8th grade class. I've got several boys who've just come from public school this year, and, you know, they're a mess. But, you know, I'd say one class out of three they participate in. And they're learning algebra. They're not learning it as fast as the kids that are, you know, totally into it. But they are learning. And I think next year, you know, they'll be back in public school next year, and they're going to have to take algebra. So at least, you know, they'll have their feet wet, and they'll have a feeling for doing it, and they'll have a sense that it's something they can do. It ain't no big deal.
How do you deal with these children who are all on different levels in the same class?
Well, if the group is small enough, you know, and if the teacher is flexible enough, it requires flexibility on the teacher's part, certainly. Kind of just kind of have to dance a little bit, you know. It's not that big a deal. You just make adjustments, or sometimes you get one of the kids who's farther along, you know, to stop, and they're usually willing. I don't make them do it, but they're usually more than willing to stop and help out the kids who are a little farther behind. And you don't use textbooks. I mean, that's, you know, if you're locked into the textbook thing, it really makes it harder. I use, you know, for pre-algebra, you know, for just the, you know, regular grades 1 through 6 arithmetic curriculum, I use a self-teaching workbook that has the answers in it, for instance, so that the kids can be checking their own work. They're not dependent on me. The only thing they need me for is if they need help. They're stuck. Otherwise, they're checking their own work and going, you know, going at their own pace, and they can be very independent about it. So
this is totally,
you know, I can teach, you know, using that workbook. You know, I can easily manage a dozen kids at a time, and they might be anywhere. They might range in age from 6 to, you know, to 11 or 12.
You're doing something totally different than most teachers would even consider in a classroom. I mean, you're giving them the answers for them to figure out for themselves. That's unheard of. And
right.
Children working with each other and supporting with each other?
Right, isn't that amazing? But there's no reason to cheat if there's no grades. It doesn't get you anywhere. And the kids, there's no competition in our school. See, learning is competitive in conventional schools. And that competition, in a certain sense, drives the kids, you know, motivates them. But not really. Plenty of research has been done now that shows that competition does not, you know, that kind of external motivation does not produce real, lasting learning. But anyway, if the kids aren't competing and they're not being judged or ranked or graded, you know, if the only reason they're learning is because they want to learn the material, then why not give them the answers? Why not entirely turn the process over to them, you know, and set them loose? And it works beautifully, because especially with a subject like math, when you get a kid who's really quick at math, really does like it, then I don't have to hold them back. You know, I sometimes have 8-year-olds or 7-year-olds doing algebra because they race through that early curriculum that I have. You know, they sleep with the damn book. You know, their mothers have to take the book away from them. No, you've got to go to sleep. I mean, you get some of these boys, especially, who are just math freaks, and they become obsessed. Now, I'm not doing that to them, but, they just race through, and then there's nothing left to do but teach them algebra. So we're never holding anybody back, you see, that kids can just go as fast in any subject as they want to go, and often they do.
I'd like to remind our listeners, you are listening to Children Come First, WAAT 750 AM on your dial. This is Dr. Daria Brzezinski, and I am speaking with Chris Mercogliano from the Albany Free School, a teacher at the Albany Free School in Albany, New York, author of Making It Up as We Go Along, The Story of the Albany Free School, and also assisting the publication of the Journal of Family Life. And Chris, would you repeat that phone number again for our listeners, where they can get information on ordering the Journal of Family Life, your publication?
Sure, it's 518-471-9532.
We'd also like to remind you, this program is on every Tuesday from 10 to 11 a.m. If you'd like information about any of our broadcasts, you may reach us in Pennsylvania at 570-639-2931 or our toll-free number at 877-PRO-KIDS. That's 877-PROKIDS. We're here with Chris. And Chris, we were talking earlier, you are working on a book about children being labeled and drugged. Tell us a little bit about that and the children who are coming to you.
Yeah, sure. What we've been seeing at our school increasingly reflects the national trend where kids are, increasing numbers of kids are being labeled, you know, with one of these crazy abbreviated designer labels or another.
Children behavior labels.
The most typical one these days is ADD, or if they add an H in there, ADHD, if the kids have a lot of energy and are, so, you know, are quote, hyperactive. And then these kids are put on powerful, you know, they call them medications, but I don't call them medications because I don't believe these kids are sick. Medication, in my mind, connotes medicine, which is something you do need to take when you're sick sometimes, but these kids aren't sick. So they're given these powerful drugs. They're usually stimulant drugs. They're closely related to amphetamines.
I thought they were antidepressants.
Well, that's becoming more popular. And they're probably in the next 10 years, the use of antidepressants will surpass the use of stimulants. But I don't think it's reached that point yet. At this point, the most common drug that these kids are given is called Ritalin. And there are about 8 million American children taking Ritalin every day at the current time. And well, no, it's going to be 8 million by the year 2000. So it's, the number has been doubling every 2 years since 1990. So that gives you an idea of how many kids we're talking about. And as you say, yes, more and more kids are being labeled as depressed these days, being given Prozac and drugs like that. So we've been just getting more and more of these kids. And way back when this craziness first started, you know, 15 years ago, Ritalin's been in use since the late 1950s. But since, you know, I forget when we got the first kid, way back when, who was being given this Ritalin and was going to public school. And Mary, our founder, Mary immediately said, no, we won't allow kids to take those kinds of psychoactive drugs. That's against our policy. You know, the child doesn't need them, you know, whatever. And that set the precedent. And in fact, those kids, especially in an environment like ours where kids can move freely, be as active as they need to be, and be in charge of themselves, they don't need those drugs. They do, you know, they don't even notice. They generally say they feel calmer when they begin coming to our school and stop taking the Ritalin. But anyway, nowadays we're getting lots of these kids. You know, it's become a real pattern. And I just hear these heart-wrenching stories from the parents and the children of these kids. They're usually boys. You know, what it was like being on these drugs, and, you know, what the school experience was like. And, you know, just you just hear one version or another of these private hells that these families have gone through. And so I decided to write a book about it. I just, you know, began reading a great deal, whatever I could get my hands on addressing the subject. And I saw big holes in the literature. There were almost everything that was written supported the idea that these kids had some kind of organic neurological disease, and they needed this, you know, without the medication they could never be normal, and it was incurable. And, you know, that was most of the stuff that I was reading, and it was sort of driving me nuts. So as I tend to do, I, you know, dove headlong into the subject. And at this point, I'm just putting the finishing touches on a book that I've titled Rid of Him.
Ah, that's what it is. Aha. I will need to collaborate on some information because I've been doing studies of the quote-unquote shooters in the last several years, as well as the children, many of the children who have been committing suicide. The town where I live in, 18 children committed suicide within an 18-month period, and one of them happened to be my son's best friend, so I began to look into it, as well as the shooter patterns, and I discovered in almost every case, bar maybe two or three, every one of the children was on some type of antidepressant or stimulant drug. And it had a reverse effect when the children became, as you said, children become obsessed with learning. That is a natural phenomenon with children. However, when they become, their minds become mixed up and charged with these drugs, these powerful drugs, in the presence of becoming their obsession to learn, oftentimes they sit in front of the television with violent TV or with the Nintendo or other kinds of games like that and become obsessed with that,
right, yeah,
which overrides the system.
That's right. Both every kid I've ever talked to who has taken either Ritalin or Prozac talks about how obsessive he felt when he was taking those drugs.
Yes, they all
exactly
begin
as you say, well, I need your data because I haven't been able to, I don't have that hard kind of data, and it's definitely missing, you know, something I need to be covering in my book.
Well,
the
culmination for me was when the Columbine incident happened. I turned to a colleague of mine and I said, I'll bet $5 those kids were on antidepressants, and of course it came out that Harris had been, we don't know anything about the other one, but Harris was definitely on an antidepressant.
Yeah, he was taking something stronger than Prozac.
Yes.
I forget the name, it's a newer one.
Luvox.
That's right, quite potent.
And what happened, if you just look at the pattern of behavior that happened to Harris prior to his the occurrence in the event at Columbine, you would notice that he was planning for his future. He went to go into the military to plan. Now, who in their right mind would be planning a career for the future when they were planning to commit suicide? So you can see by the very actions that this child on this powerful, powerful drug was definitely not in his own mind. And I've seen it time and time again with these children on drugs. And, you know, this is my own profession I'm talking about here. We really need to take a look at what we are doing to our children. We are creating a whole entire society of addicted children. And what happens is when these children reach puberty, if they've been on the drugs prior to puberty, when they reach puberty, it has the reverse effect. So a child who has been depressed on antidepressants and becomes slow and sluggish retaliates, so to speak, when they reach puberty and turn the opposite cheek, so to speak.
That's right. It's a depressing subject.
Yeah, I know.
So few of the American people know anything. There's just so much mythology that's out there and stuff, mythology that's being widely promoted by the drug companies.
Correct.
By the doctors, that, you know, by the whole industry that promotes this approach to dealing with kids who are having a hard time.
Well, the thing that I see is all of the titles that we use for all of these behaviors, when you look right down into the nitty-gritty, these are all normal childhood behaviors. But parents who have taken unresponsible actions towards their children instead of being responsible as parents allow them to be drugged in order to be able to control them rather than allowing to be the children and to be the active children that they are. It's more of a control issue,
yeah,
as we have
big,
in our
it's
schools.
It's a big control issue. And I would add to that, especially for parents that might be listening who are, you know, who see their kids having a hard time, whose kids are difficult to deal with, I would add that some kids are genuinely, I use the word distressed. You know, they don't have a disease. You know, there's nothing wrong with them. But for whatever reason, there could be 10 different reasons why they might be distressed. They may have lost someone in their family. They may, you know, they
well,
may
well, how
be
about
the
50% divorce rate? I
they
mean,
may
that's
be at
enough.
The bottom of the heap, you know, in the sibling, you know, pecking order at home, or I don't know. You know what I'm saying? There could be dozens. You know, maybe they're being abused. Maybe their parents are fighting every night, and there's just nothing but combat in the house. And, added to that, they're watching violent television all the time. Or, I don't know, the list is practically endless. But some of these kids are genuinely distressed, and they're trying to tell us that. That's where I say they have an attention deficit. Sure, they're not getting the attention they need. They're crying out for attention. Their behaviors are saying, "Pay attention to me. I'm hurting. You know, part of me is hurting or missing, or I'm not getting something I very deeply need." And those kids, you know, I don't have a problem saying those kids have a problem, and they have a problem that needs to be solved. But I do have trouble with saying that those kids have a disease or a permanent neurological disorder that needs medical treatment.
Well, again,
drug
we're,
treatment.
We're
that
doing
I do not. I have yet to see an instance in my 25 years of working with, you know, some pretty crazy kids. Sometimes I've yet to see an instance where I would have said that child had a neurological disorder. I've just never seen it. So if this is so prevalent, why, you know, I mean, I don't work with a million kids at a time, but I've been working in the same place for 25 years. I've seen a lot of kids come and go, and why have I not seen one single instance? Well, that's why I wrote the book. I mean, the whole thing just seemed insane to me, so I hope I will succeed in making my point.
Well, I think we can positively look at these kinds of things if people, we continue to try and educate people with regard to looking at, and the stigma that's attached to having a child who is a disruptive child in school and out of school, as opposed to a child who is drugged and labeled ADD. I mean, I've seen parents who walk around actually with pride with the fact that their child has some disorder and that can be labeled.
It's a strange thing.
Well, and also the fact that they are reimbursed by the government for having, not only are the parents reimbursed, but also the school district is reimbursed.
Yeah, there's a whole economics to it. That's
exactly.
Right.
So, you know, we're not about to get away from this very rapidly with the kind of mindset that allows these things to happen. I'd like to remind you, you are listening to Children Come First. This is Dr. Daria Brzezinski on 750 AM WAAT. We are here every Tuesday from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. with speakers from all over the United States regarding education, children, families, prevention, health, and many other issues. This week we are speaking with Chris Mercogliano from the Albany Free School in Albany, New York, who wrote the book Making It Up As We Go Along, the story of the Albany Free School, and who is the publisher of the Journal of Family Life magazine. And Chris, will you give us again that phone number for the Journal of Family Life in case people would like to get a copy of your magazine?
518-471-9532.
And your email?
That's jflmag@aol.com.
If you'd like more information regarding our subjects that we have on this broadcast, or someone you'd like to have on our broadcast, or if you'd like to request information on the products that we are talking about here, the books, the tapes, and the people, you may call us in Pennsylvania, area code 570-639-2931, or toll free 877-PRO-KIDS. That's 877-PROKIDS. Chris, we have about a minute or two to wrap up. What would you like to tell our audience, or what would you like to talk about in these last few moments?
Well, when I look forward in time, I get both discouraged and I get very optimistic. I get discouraged because, you know, we're cutting more and more kids out of the herd, as it were, and shoving these powerful drugs down their throats. But at the same time, I see a lot of, you know, a lot of renewal and a lot of people kind of waking up and realizing that there are alternatives, that we don't just have to mindlessly kind of sheep-like way funnel our kids into the conventional school system. I mean, you've got over a million homeschoolers at this point who have realized that their children belong to them and they don't belong to the state. And the homeschoolers are doing the neatest thing. I mean, if you start reading homeschool magazines, which I like to do, you know, the stuff those kids are doing, those families are doing together is just extraordinary. They're an inspiration to all of us.
That's kind of a subject for another. We can go on that one again.
People are starting schools all over the place, too, which is wonderful.
Our time is up, and we'd like to thank you for being our guest today. This is Dr. Daria Brzezinski. We are on Children Come First, WAAT, 750 a.m. on your dial. We're here every week, Tuesdays, 10 to 11 a.m. Thank you for joining us, and see you next week.
Celebrating our first anniversary of the new sound of radio and family service, this is WAAT, Oliphant, Scranton, Wilkes-Barre, the Poconos. This is The Way, 750.
outside me was darker by the day. So I promised to stay here close beside him. Surely God would want his children saved.